Cinderella, or The Little Glass Slipper by Charles Perrault. Narration, Katie Haig. Sound, Patrick Martinez-Bourna. Once there was a gentleman who married, for his second wife, the proudest and most haughty woman that was ever seen. She had, by a former husband, two daughters of her own humour, and they were indeed exactly like her in all things. He had likewise, by another wife, a young daughter, but of unparalleled goodness and sweetness of temper, which she took from her mother, who was the best creature in the world. No sooner were the ceremonies of the wedding over, but the stepmother began to show herself in her colours. She could not bear the good qualities of this pretty girl, and the less because they made her own daughters appear the more odious. She employed her in the meanest work of the house. She scoured the dishes and tables and so on, and cleaned Madame's chamber from top to bottom, and those of Mrs. her daughters. She lay up in a sorry garret, upon a wretched straw bed, while her sisters lay in fine rooms, with floors all inlaid, upon beds of the very newest fashion, and where they had looking glasses so large that they might see themselves at their full length from head to foot. The poor girl bore all patiently, and dared not tell her father, who would have told her off, for his wife governed him entirely. When she had done her work, she used to go into the chimney corner and sit down among cinders and ashes, which made her commonly be called Cinderbreech. But the youngest, who was not so rude and uncivil as the eldest, called her Cinderella. However, Cinderella, notwithstanding her mean apparel, was 100 times handsomer than her sisters, though they were always dressed very richly. It happened that the king's son gave a ball, and invited all persons of fashion to it. Our young misses were also invited, for they cut a very grand figure among the quality. They were mightily delighted at this invitation, and wonderfully busy in choosing out such gowns, petticoats, and headclothes as might best become them. This was a new trouble to Cinderella, for it was she who ironed her sisters' linen and plaited their ruffles. They talked all day long of nothing but how they should be dressed.
"For my part," said the eldest, "I will wear my red velvet suit with French trimming."
"And I," said the youngest, "shall only have my usual petticoat, but then, to make amends for that, I will put on my gold-flowered manteau and my diamond stomacher, which is far from being the most ordinary one in the world."
They sent for the best tirewoman they could get to make up their headdresses and adjust their double pinners, and they had their red brushes and patches from the fashionable maker. Cinderella was likewise called up to them to be consulted in all these matters, for she had excellent notions, and advised them always for the best, nay, and offered her service to dress their heads, which they were very willing she should do. As she was doing this, they said to her,
"Cinderella, would you not be glad to go to the ball?"
"Ah," she said, "you only jeer at me. It is not for such as I am to go thither."
"Thou art right," replied they. "It would make the people laugh to see a Cinderbreech at a ball."
Anyone but Cinderella would have dressed their heads awry, but she was very good, and dressed them perfectly well. They were almost 2 days without eating, so much they were transported with joy. They broke above a dozen of laces in trying to be laced up close, that they might have a fine, slender shape, and they were continually at their looking-glass. At last the happy day came. They went to court, and Cinderella followed them with her eyes as long as she could, and when she had lost sight of them, she fell a-crying. Her godmother, who saw her all in tears, asked her what was the matter.
I wish I could...
She was not able to speak the rest, being interrupted by her tears and sobbing. This godmother of hers, who was a fairy, said to her,
"Thou wishest thou couldest go to the ball,
Is it not so?
Yes,
cried Cinderella with a great sigh. Well, said her godmother, be but a good girl, and I will contrive that thou shalt go. Then she took her into her chamber and said to her, run into the garden and bring me a pumpkin. Cinderella went immediately to gather the finest she could get and brought it to her godmother. Not being able to imagine how this pumpkin could make her go to the ball. Her godmother scooped out all the inside of it, leaving nothing but the rind. When done, she struck it with her wand, and the pumpkin was instantly turned into a fine coach, gilded all over with gold. She then went to look into her mousetrap, where she found 6 mice all alive, and ordered Cinderella to lift up a little the trapdoor, when giving each mouse, as it went out, a little tap with her wand. The mouse was at that moment turned into a fair horse, which altogether made a very fine set of 6 horses of a beautiful mouse-coloured dapple grey. Being at a loss for a coachman, I will go and see, says Cinderella, if there be never a rat in the rat trap, that we may make a coachman of him.
Thou art right, replied her godmother. Go and look.
Cinderella brought the trap to her, and in it there were 3 huge rats. The fairy made choice of one of the 3, which had the largest beard, and having touched him with her wand, he was turned into a fat, jolly coachman, who had the smartest whiskers eyes ever beheld. After that, she said to her, go again into the garden, and you will find 6 lizards behind the watering pot. Bring them to me. She had no sooner done so, but her godmother turned them into 6 footmen, who skipped up immediately behind the coach, with their liveries all bedecked with gold and silver, and clung as close behind it as if they had done nothing else their whole lives. The fairy then said to Cinderella,
well, you see here an equipage fit to go to the ball with. Are you not pleased with it?
Oh, yes, cried she. But must I go thither as I am, in these horrible old rags?
Her godmother only just touched her with her wand, and, at the same instant, her clothes were turned into cloth of gold and silver, all beset with jewels. This done, she gave her a pair of glass slippers, the prettiest in the whole world. Being thus decked out, she got up into her coach, but her godmother, above all things, commanded her not to stay till after midnight, telling her at the same time that if she stayed at the ball one moment longer, her coach would be a pumpkin again, her horses mice, her coachman a rat, her footmen lizards, and her clothes become just as they were before. She promised her godmother she would not fail to leave the ball before midnight, and then away she drove, scarce able to contain herself for joy. The king's son, who was told that a great princess, whom nobody knew, was come, ran out to receive her. He gave her his hand as she alighted out of the coach, and led her into the hall among all the company. There was immediately a profound silence. They left off dancing, and the violin ceased playing, so attentive was everyone in contemplating the singular beauty of this unknown newcomer. Nothing was then heard but a confused noise of,
oh, how handsome she is! How handsome she is!
The king himself, old as he was, could not help ogling her and telling the queen softly
that it was a long time since he had seen so beautiful and lovely a creature.
All the ladies were busied in considering her clothes and headdress, that they might have some made next day after the same pattern, provided they could meet with such fine materials and as able hands to make them. The king's son conducted her to the most honourable seat, and afterwards took her out to dance with him. She danced so very gracefully that they admired her even more. A fine collation was served up, whereof the young prince ate not a morsel, so intently was he busied in gazing on her. she went and sat down by her sisters, showing them 1,000 civilities, giving them part of the oranges and citrons which the prince had presented her with, which very much surprised them, for they did not know her. While Cinderella was thus amusing her sisters, she heard the clock strike 11 3/4, whereupon she immediately made a curtsy to the company and hastened away as fast as she could. At home, she ran to seek out her godmother, and after having thanked her, she said she could not but heartily wish she might go next day to the ball, because the king's son had desired her. As she was eagerly telling her godmother whatever had passed at the ball, her two sisters knocked at the door, which Cinderella ran and opened. "How long you have stayed!" cried she, gaping, rubbing her eyes, and stretching herself as if she had just been awakened out of her sleep. She had not, however, any manner of inclination to sleep since they went from home.
"If thou hadst been at the ball," said one of her sisters, "thou wouldst not have been tired with it. There came thither the finest princess, the most beautiful ever seen with mortal eyes. She showed us 1,000 civilities and gave us oranges and citrons."
Cinderella was transported with joy. She asked them the name of that princess, but they told her they did not know it, and that the king's son was very anxious to learn it, and would give all the world to know who she was. At this, Cinderella, smiling, replied, "She must then be very beautiful indeed. Lord, how happy you have been! Could not I see her? Ah, oh, dear Miss Charlotte, do lend me your yellow suit of clothes which you wear every day."
"Ay, to be sure," cried Miss Charlotte, "lend my clothes to such a dirty cinderbreech as thou art. Who's the fool then?"
Cinderella, indeed, expected some such answer, and was very glad of the refusal, for she would have been sadly put to it if her sister had lent her what she asked for, jestingly. The next day, the two sisters were at the ball, and so was Cinderella, but dressed even more magnificently than before. The king's son was always by her, and never ceased his compliments and amorous speeches to her, to whom all this was so far from being tiresome, that she quite forgot what her godmother had recommended to her, so that she, at last, counted the clock striking 12, when she took it to be no more than 11. She then rose up and fled, as nimble as a deer. The prince followed, but could not overtake her. She left behind one of her glass slippers, which the prince took up most carefully. She got home, but quite out of breath, without coach or footman, and in her nasty old clothes, having nothing left of all her finery but one of the little slippers, which was similar to the one she had dropped. The guards at the palace gate were asked if they had not seen a princess go out, and they said they had seen nobody go out but a young girl, very meanly dressed, and who had more the air of a poor country wench than a gentlewoman. When the two sisters returned from the ball, Cinderella asked them if they had been well diverted, and if the fine lady had been there. They told her yes, but that she hurried away immediately when it struck 12, and with so much haste that she dropped one of her little glass slippers, the prettiest in the world, and which the king's son had taken up, that he had done nothing but look at it during all the latter part of the ball, and that most certainly he was very much in love with the beautiful person who owned the little slipper. What they said was very true, for a few days after, the king's son caused it to be proclaimed by sound of trumpet that he would marry the lady whose foot fit the slipper perfectly. His servants began to try it upon the princesses, then the duchesses, and all the court, but in vain. It was brought to the two sisters, who did all they possibly could to thrust their feet into the slipper, but they could not do it. Cinderella, who saw all this and knew her slipper, said to them, laughing, "Let me see if it will not fit me." Her sisters burst out a laughing and began to banter her. The gentleman who was sent to try the slipper looked earnestly at Cinderella, and, finding her very handsome, said it was but just that she should try, and that he had orders to let everyone make trial. He invited Cinderella to sit down, and putting the slipper to her foot, he found it went on very easily and fitted her as if it had been made of wax. The astonishment her two sisters were in was excessively great, but still abundantly greater when Cinderella pulled out of her pocket the other slipper and put it on her foot. Thereupon in came her godmother, who, having touched Cinderella's clothes with her wand, made them richer and more magnificent than any of those she had had before. And now her two sisters found her to be that fine, beautiful lady whom they had seen at the ball. They threw themselves at her feet to beg pardon for all the ill treatment she had suffered at their hands. Cinderella took them up, and as she embraced them, cried that she forgave them with all her heart, and desired them always to love her. She was conducted to the young prince, dressed as she was. He thought her more charming than ever, and a few days after married her. Cinderella, who was no less good than beautiful, gave her two sisters lodgings in the palace, and that very same day matched them with two great lords of the court.